But let's get into a topic a lot of people have been buzzing about. You've heard a lot in the news lately about the so-called defund police legislation that was introduced and passed on January 13th. Thought we'd get a closer look on this one because I've read some of his comments and those of other lawmakers on this particular topic. And State Senator Dave Severson was nice enough to carve some time out of his day for us. Dave, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Riley. Doing fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you for taking time for us this morning. Looking this over, House Bill 3653 passed the House in a 60-50 vote after being approved by the Senate just before 5 a.m. Let's get into this a little bit about this bill and how this dropped and how much time you had to go through it.
Yeah, that's the part that's frustrating. And when I tell people, it's hard to believe, but they introduced the bill at like 3:30 in the morning, and they gave us 1 hour to look at it before voting on this 600-page bill, and we had a vote on it at 4:30 in the morning when the press had gone and most of the advocates that were concerned, law enforcement people had already left, and they snuck it through. In all my years, we've never had legislation introduced at 4:30 or passed at 4:30 in the morning with very limited debate. They allowed us two senators to ask questions, and we're only allowed to ask two questions. And then they did this quick vote, and it's all part of an agenda that really is going to make our communities less safe. It makes law enforcement out to be the bad guy, and just really disappointing that people supported this bill. And locally, not all of them. Obviously, Brian Stewart over in Freeport was voted against it. Joe Sosnowski voted against it. I voted against it. Other than that, former Representative John Cabello voted against it. But other than that, others voted for it, and it's just very disappointing.
Looking over some of the reaction to it, the Illinois Law Enforcement Coalition statement, we're extremely disappointed and saddened in the process, the lack of discussion with members of the law enforcement community, and the ultimate outcome in the Illinois General Assembly. The lawmakers who voted in favor of this criminal-favoring legislation ignored the pleas of more than 112,000 petition-signing citizens and refused to listen to the concerns of law enforcement. Our communities will be less safe if this legislation is signed into law. We urge the governor to stand up for the majority of Illinois citizens who value their lives, possessions, and well-being, and veto this bill and its extreme provisions. Today's outcome, although it's ominous for Illinois, does not diminish our commitment. Our members will continue to use all authorized means to protect every community. What does this bill do to law enforcement?
Yeah, and that's one thing that should be interesting. This whole bill was drafted without any conversations with state's attorneys, with sheriffs, with the FBI, with police departments, and unanimously they all oppose it. So that by itself should tell you a number of things. But the way it was originally drafted, and thanks to thousands of phone calls the last day, the worst part, making law enforcement officials personally liable for every stop they make, that part at least was taken out. But what's still left in there are things like no cash bail, which means, and in New York where they have this, we have heard horror story after horror story of people that have committed horrendous crimes, get arrested, no cash bail, so they get right back out again, and then they commit another serious crime, or there's no incentive for them to ever show up for court. If there's no bail, then why show up for court? And these are potentially for any crime that's committed, people will be able to be right back out in the street. And for the life of me, I don't understand why members of the Black Caucus were so adamant about having this in the bill, because, in many times it's the minority community that is the biggest victims of these, you know, home thefts, of these assaults, of these murders, of these rapes. And yet they're the very same community that are going to be negatively affected by it.
Yeah, that is somewhat of a head-scratcher. Some of the things that I'm looking at removes due process protections for police officers, including eliminating sworn affidavits and punishing them based upon anonymous and unverified complaints.
Yes, what that means is before, if someone was to file a complaint against the police officer, someone would have to have a witness. There'd have to be at least a sworn affidavit to be able to put in that file. Now, what this says is anyone can file an anonymous complaint against the police officer without any proof, and it has to stay in that police officer's file forever, an anonymous complaint. No other state does that. It is just, it's unbelievable that they would eliminate any protection or due process. We don't do that for any other employee, but we're going to do that now against police officers.
Yeah, the idea that that hangs around, that we've all heard that term. That's on your permanent record. Well, this is what you're talking about.
Exactly right. Yep.
Severely limits accountability for accomplices to murder by dramatically amending the felony murder rule. If I have that right, Joe and I go out, we're going to rob some guy. I shoot the guy that we're robbing. Joe's along with me as my getaway driver. He goes down for felony murder because he's an accomplice with me.
Yep, not anymore.
Not anymore.
So, yeah, now when you work in tandem, the person who did the shooting could be charged, but the person who didn't get the shooting potentially will not be charged for that crime. So then we have a potential fight going over who was the one who actually pulled the trigger if there's two people committing the crime. And so it gives the defense attorneys one more tool to have a loophole to allow their the shooters off the hook, because now we charge everybody that was involved in the shooting. This is going to change that, and so you're going to have to prove which one actually did the shooting, and then the other one gets to have a lesser crime. So, again, why would we ever, for some serious crimes like that, why would we turn around and say, we're just going to let them off the hook? How is that making our community any safer?
If you're just joining us, we're spending some time with State Senator Dave Severs, and we're talking House Bill 3653 passing the House 60-50 vote after being approved by the Senate. That's headed to the governor's desk. It does appear, Dave, right, that the governor is going to sign off on this.
Oh, sure. He has told people he was going to sign it. And again, after seeing what's happened in New York, after seeing what's happened in New Chicago with Kim Fox letting people out all the time with serious records, we're going to file suit. We know, you know, what's sad is we know it hasn't worked anywhere. It's made communities less safe. It makes law enforcement more at risk. And yet the governor's going to sign it because he wants to placate his party, and he wants to put politics above the public safety. And, you know, what's sad is it's going to take some victims and crimes occurring from people who have been released that should not have been released, or crimes that were committed because law enforcement was stuck in classrooms and not on the street. When that happens, you know, then the public is going to be outraged, and then we're going to have to come back and do legislation to close these loopholes. But in the meantime, this bill is going to certainly make Illinois families less safe, and people need to contact their legislators and either demand that they support changes to it or repealing it, because this can't be right. We cannot continue to tie the hands of law enforcement, whose job is already so difficult to do.
Some of the other provisions that leap out: makes it harder to prosecute those resisting or obstructing a peace officer, firefighter, or correctional employee.
Yes. So if you're obstructing a police officer, you're not going to be charged for that. So here a police officer is trying to do his job. Maybe it's a domestic violence. Maybe it's a protesters. And people are interfering with the police officer. Now it makes it almost impossible to arrest those individuals. And speaking of that, it also says that during riots, that it bans the use of tear gas or rubber bullets. So here, you can't shoot them, you can't use tear gas, you can't use rubber bullets, unless, here's the key word, every one of the protesters has been told that they are going to be using tear gas and rubber bullets. Now, when you've got 500 people walking down the street screaming and rioting and burglarizing things, how are the police going to notify every one of those 500 people? They announce it over a bullhorn, you know, disperse or we're going to use tear gas, but a lot of these people won't hear that. And so all it takes is one person to say, I never heard them tell me that. Okay, City of Rockford, give me a couple million dollars. And so it basically will eliminate the use of tear gas or rubber bullets, giving police no authorities when it comes to rioting and when it comes to terrorizing a city. All they can do is just, I guess, tap them on the shoulder and say, would you mind please not destroying property, because that's about all the police will be able to do.
Wow. And then, as you mentioned, then the city's on the hook for that one person out of the 500 who says, you know, I didn't hear anything about that.
Exactly. And then municipalities will settle, which unfortunately, communities like Rockford and others, we've all read in the past, when there's something that's happened, they quickly open up the checkbook and they write huge checks, and that sends the absolute wrong message that, hey, commit a crime and just say that the police overreacted and make them open up a checkbook and pay us. But that's taxpayer money. When the police department or when the city pays out millions of dollars in settlements, that comes right out of your property taxes. And so people need to understand those giveaways we're paying for, not some government somewhere. We are the government.
One of the things we often hear complaints about are things called unfunded mandates, where a governing body will decide that, hey, this municipality has to do this, and they have to do it right now, and that's going to cost tons of money, and they need to come up with a way to pay for it. Unfunded mandate. Requiring all law enforcement agencies to phase in body cameras without any resources to help fund the cost. I've already seen chiefs of police weigh in around the state saying we can't afford this. We don't have this kind of money.
So it requires every police department, small communities, large communities, to come up with the expensive body cameras. And I'm all in favor of body cameras because, interesting enough, body cameras usually prove that the police officers were correct, but the cost to purchase body cameras, and then the cost to maintain them, and the cost of the equipment to record and keep records of old things are very expensive. And this bill says if you don't do that, we're going to take any state funding away from their police department. So if you don't do this, we're going to even take more money away from you, which is going to drive up property taxes. And then there's a huge long list of mandatory new training that has to be done, putting police officers back into classrooms when they should be out on the streets. So a significant amount of mandates. And it is frustrating that a number of municipalities now are, in the last week, have called and said, we need the state to help us fund all these things. And it's like, well, where were you before when we were asking you for help to stop this bill? Now it's going to be on you and on the property taxpayer. So we're hoping municipalities will get to the governor as well and say, stop this, or we'll get to those legislators who supported this to say, you know, you've got to support repealing some of these things and bring some common sense back in, because for Rockford area, you're talking about millions of dollars in increased cost. That's coming right out of property taxes, which we're already way too high on. So, again, there's very little in this bill that is worth having. Our law enforcement does such a great job locally. We've had virtually no complaints. People support our law enforcement. And to tie their hands and then to make the costs go up is just going to make their job more difficult, which means our communities are going to be less safe.
And part of tying their hands, Dave, limits the purchase of specialized tactical military equipment. We've heard this this hue and cry for quite a long while that police departments over militarized, and you know that's up for that's been debated quite strongly. But this builds right in that you are limited in what a police department can equip itself with.
Right. So it's mainly dealing with things like some of these riots, where you want to be able to purchase some of this expensive equipment that normally you can't afford to buy, but the military has old equipment that they're willing to sell for next to nothing that they could sell to local law enforcement that they can use in those rare cases where they need to have some for when it's rioting going on, or if there's a terrorist activity, or if they need to get into a home. This equipment helps protect police officers, and yet the bill says no. You can't buy additional equipment. You can't buy military equipment. It's like, well, why not? That's a decision the local taxpayers, local officials need to make based on what they think their needs are. And yet, we sit in Springfield, and the governor and some of these leaders are out there saying, we know better, and we're not going to allow you to purchase any federal law enforcement equipment.
All right, and as we said earlier, for those who may be just joining us, I asked you a few moments ago, there's no doubt about the governor putting a signature down on this one. There's not going to be hesitation. There's not going to be a rethink. He's going to plunge ahead with this, correct?
He's going to plunge ahead. Remember, this is the same governor that's surrounded by bodyguards that are armed. You know, he's protected. There's no problem. He's not worried about that. But what's disappointing is some of the local legislators who supported it, and many of them across the state who supported it, knowing full well that this is not going to make our city and our state any safer. As I said earlier, all we have to look at is New York that's done this and Chicago has done this, both getting off of record high years of crimes, murders, assaults, and yet we're going to go down that same path that these failed municipalities have done. And it's sad, and what's going to happen is someone's going to die, and then finally the legislature is going to wake up, and then we're going to have to repeal some of these things. But it's not going to happen, unfortunately, until there's a bad outcome, until somebody gets hurt or dies. And then I guess all we can do is hold those people who supported this accountable for what happened. But it's just sad because this didn't have to happen.
You recommend citizens get in touch with their legislator on this and let them know how they feel. Is there anything else about this bill, how it's rolled out, what's in it, what's going to happen here that I haven't asked you that you would want people to know?
No, I think just the, again, if I, people should be angry that the idea that any government would sneak a 600-page bill out at 4 o'clock in the morning and say, you know, you've got 1 hour to vote on it. There is no way any legislator read that bill. So those who supported it had no idea. Some staff may have told them some of the things that were in it, but they obviously didn't read the bill. They didn't see it. And the fact that there was no hearings, that law enforcement was not allowed to weigh in, and that they do it at 4 o'clock in the morning is just unconscionable. And no government at any level should ever be allowed to have that kind of closed, secretive elections, or not elections, but votes, without any public input. That just, we cannot allow that to happen.
State Senator Dave Severson, thank you very much for cutting some time out of your day for us. Very informative. I appreciate your take on this. I appreciate your stance on this one. And you know, thanks for filling everybody in on how you feel about it and what's in it.
Thank you. Thanks for allowing me to share on it. And if they need more information, they can always go to my website, or they can call our office. But anything people can do, they should be outraged by that. So we appreciate all the calls we've received so far. And people should know we're doing the best we can to repeal it.
Great. Dave, thank you very much, and enjoy the rest of your day. We appreciate it.
You bet.
There's State Senator Dave Severson.